Okay, so good morning. This is the presentation of the thesis, Social Robot Navigation in Urban Dynamic Environments by Gonzalo Ferrer. The advisor is Professor Alberto Sanfeliu. So this is the presentation. The candidate will have Gonzalo Ferrer about 45 minutes for presentation, and then we will discuss the topics. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you very much for the introduction. So I will present the work that I've been doing at the Institute of Robotics in Barcelona under the supervision of Professor Sanfeliu. So why are we interested in studying dynamic environments? Well, under certain circumstances, the navigation problem is considered to be solved. However, these conditions are normally simple conditions. And what happens when these conditions get a little more complicated, like in this video, where there are thousands of interactions taking place at the same time, and we somehow need to study new algorithms if we want to deploy robots reliably in these human environments. So our main objective, as I said, is to deploy our robots and having navigation capabilities at least equally to people have. In this environment, they can successfully navigate and there's no collision. So this will be our final objective. And we know that these capabilities are very high. So the resources that I have used at the IRI are these two robotic platforms, the TV and Davo robots. And our objective was to deploy them in urban environments. And we will take advantage of their agile capabilities. They are built on top of CQIR MAP-B, so their trajectories that they can describe are very smooth and very nice. And secondly, they have this pleasant appearance. So it's very important if we want to deploy them with in environments where there are people, because there will be interaction between the robot and people. So the state of the art in robot navigation in the presence of human is very extensive. Here at the Institute, we have done some works too, and we were successfully navigating in Barcelona street. And well, we were able to localize, deal with objects, but as I said, this is limited by some the configurations that we were considering at that time. So most of the obstacles were static. And this work was done in 2011. There were also other works. Studying robot navigation in the presence of human, like this example in a museum, also in an exhibition. And the robot was navigating in a downtown. And in this case, the robot was interacting in a shopping mall. And also, there are examples of the robot being aware of people in indoor environments. Right, so there's a lot of work done here. The methodology that we have followed in this work is the following. On this first step, it's very important to have a prior estimation of how the system behaves on a simulated environment. Why is this important? Because you cannot test any system when there is people involved. It might be dangerous, and you will also need a lot of time to tune these parameters. So our first step on multiple approaches to robot navigation that I will explain later is it will be a constant. First of all, simulations. Then we will test and validate our algorithms in what we have called a control real environment. This is an intermediate step because here we are controlling the number of obstacles, the number of people that are interacting, and so on. And finally, we are ready to test our algorithms in an uncontrolled real environment. It might be a city. In this case, we have tested the navigation in the campus north, where there are students that attend to class, and it's very, very similar to a urban environment. So the work that I have done is divided into two big blocks. On the first one, I will present our work on human motion prediction. And the second part, I will talk about robot navigation. I will start proposing some simple navigation approaches. And then on the last integration of the robot navigation, I will try to consider all the contributions that we have done on prediction and our lessons learned on the initial robot navigation approaches that we have proposed. So let's start by the first block, the human motion prediction. Just imagine that we are in a urban environment, in this case in the Barcelona Robot Lab, campus north, and we detect some person. So by prediction information, what we understand is that we need to somehow describe the future trajectories that this person is going to do in a near future. Well, in this first section, I will describe the environment as a set of destinations. And before describing these trajectories, I will divide each of the maps that we are studying in a set of destinations, that is important goals or places in this scene. So this set of destinations, as I said, describe the environment. The person position is a two-dimensional state, and we can observe the trajectory of a person over time, starting at the initial time up to the current time. So the main feature that we will use to calculate which is the destination that someone is going to will be this phi angle. Since we are observing the trajectory, we have these path positions, we can calculate the current orientation of the person at this instant of time. The angle difference between this orientation and the vector pointing to the destination that we are considering will give us this phi variable that will help us to describe which is the intention of a person to reach one destination or other. So we have modeled these phi variables as Gaussian variables, and in this picture you can see that we have centered the distributions for two destinations centered at this vector pointing to each of the destinations. And for this concrete example where the person is its orientation is this vector, this will be the probabilities that we are calculating. So it's just for one instant of time. What we can do now is observe over a period of time these phi variables, since we can observe the trajectories. And all these components will help to calculate which is the most expectable destination in the environment. So just recall, with a pair of positions, we can calculate the phi variable. This is the difference angle between the orientation and the vector pointing to the destination. And well, assuming that they are conditionally independent, we can calculate this probability by the multiplication of all these components. And then applying Bayes' rule, we can calculate what we want, the probability of reaching a destination according to the observations. So we have proposed two methods. The first one is the sliding window method, where we are just considering some previous observations, not the whole trajectory. And a second approach is the time decay. We are also using a time window, considering some approaches, but in this case, we are weighting these distributions using an exponentially shaped window. To validate our model, we have used the Edinburgh database. And in this case, we have distinguished 8 different destinations in this scene. Some corresponds to an elevator, stairs. All these destinations are important places in the scene. And we have used a second database in Freiburg, where we also have detected 5 different destinations. In this case, we have obtained these destinations applying an expectation maximization algorithm. And well, with these two databases, we can validate our methods, our results. We have compared our two methods, the Bayesian motion intentionality prediction, sliding window, with two state-of-the-art methods. One is a geometric-based method that is takes geometric information, like the one that we are using, because the phi variable is also a geometric feature, and the other is a place dependent, where it tries to cluster primitives of trajectories and classifies the prediction based on that. So with these two comparisons, our method performs better. We are averaging the performance in this table. Performs better, but it's not so important to predict where the person is going once we have observed the whole trajectory. So in this graphic, the zero will be that we have the start of the trajectory, and one is the final of the trajectory. So we are observing the whole trajectory. And what we're interested is in a method that is able to score high performances in this classification of destinations, but only observing little observations of this trajectory. So by doing that, we're able to adapt to changes. And this is clearly shown here. From these trajectories, we have selected what we have called an abnormal set of trajectories, like this one in this example, where a person at the beginning was walking apparently to this destination in the bottom, but in the middle of its trajectory changed its path. So it's very difficult to classify to understand that this person will finally get there. It's almost impossible, any human could do. But what we need to be sure is that we can adapt quickly to these changes. So our methods are able to adapt quickly, and they score better than other approaches, especially the place dependent, which in these complex configurations are not able to provide good performance. So I have presented these maps as a set of destinations. Mm-hmm. Now I will talk about the generation of trajectories. To do that, in this section, there are three points that I will present. First of all is the social force model. Then we'll talk about the behavior estimation. And finally, we will be ready to generate trajectories, human trajectories. So the social force model was proposed by Helding in 1905, and it's the key method that we are using not only to predict trajectories, but it will appear later in the navigation, in the navigation algorithms that we have proposed. And it says the following: we treat people as two-dimensional particles, and the trajectories that these particles are describing completely depends on these virtual forces. So these virtual forces are composed of a steering force that is an attractive force trying to get to a point in the scene or a destination, and the interaction forces that corresponds to the to changes in these trajectories if there are other agents, other obstacles, or a robot, even a robot in the scene. So for the steering force, we need to calculate which of these destinations, if there are several destinations, is the one that this person is going to. And here, as I explained before in this section, thanks to the probability calculated by the intentionality prediction, we can say that which is the most expectable destination, and we will choose that goal to calculate, according to this formula, the steering force. And for the interaction forces, we have interactions between the central person and other people in the scene, like in this example. The interaction forces are calculated using this formula, an exponential in modulo. And there are also other interactions, not only with people, but also with obstacles. And we have extended this model to consider also robots. So to do that, we consider interaction between a person and a robot, our robot in our concrete case, because each of the parameters will be different for each robot. So with all these components, the steering force trying to get to a goal in the scene, and all the interaction forces, this summation will be the resultant force. We can calculate trajectories thanks to this force. So the two parameters for the obstacle and person interaction, the person and person interaction, were already studied, and some values are provided by other authors. We are interested in providing these values for the for the interaction force for the robot and person interaction, right? So we have defined this raw parameter as a set of the parameters that we want to study. And what we did to obtain these parameters was to real experimentation with some volunteers that they were told to walk in an environment with our robot, the TV robot. And we, on the first step, obtained the gap parameter that corresponds to the steering force. And on the second part of the parameter calculation, we obtained the parameters that were describing this interaction between the 3D robot and people. Right, so now I will talk about the behavior definition. I have just explained that we have a set of parameters for each kind of interaction. So we have one for people, other for obstacles, and other for robots. And these parameters correspond to this interaction force, right? So we observed some problems when we were doing experimentations, and it's because there's a high variability in the outcome of this prediction. So just using a single set of predictions to describe the trajectories that all of us will do was not very accurate, and we wanted to provide a more precise interaction force that was able to describe reality. So we have defined these behaviors. Imagine these two interactions, this interaction between these two people, and what the behavior response is to the answer that to the question if the resultant trajectory that this person is going to do considers this person in the in its path in this case, or goes more directly to it. It's just a broad question. But at the end, we believe that there are a different set of parameters for these interactions, and by doing that, we were able to provide a more precise definition, a trajectory prediction. So there will be a set of behaviors, and for each of these behaviors corresponds a set of parameters that I will now explain how can we calculate them. So we are observing trajectories over time, and this is how can we update our beliefs that the interaction between these two people corresponds to one behavior or another. So we are observing its position over time. We can calculate its acceleration, thus the virtual force that we are describing. And we also know which is the destination that this person is going to reach in a near future. At the same time, using the parameters, we can calculate the interaction force. And we will want to minimize the estimated interaction force, that is the difference between the real social force and the calculated by interactions. We want to minimize these vectors. So we propose to use likelihood function that is Gaussian. And well, we will update all the probabilities to this interaction corresponds to a behavior or another using a Heiden-Markov model. And finally, we can now provide a trajectory prediction algorithm that describes trajectories in the near future. So we describe people as this state consists of position and velocity in a two-dimensional in two dimensions. And this state is subject to these differential constraints. It's a double integrator, and we need to propagate it, its velocity and the acceleration. So we can calculate directly its acceleration using the social force model. And we can enhance this interaction, these forces, using the behavior estimation. So this summation will update the system. And here is the algorithm that we are using to propagate all the states of people over time. So for the case of just one person, we have its position. We also have some uncertainty due to the its detection and its tracking. And we propagate this this position over time until we get to this final destination, or we die, or we get to some horizon time. What happens when there are multiple people in this scene? Well, we do this propagation simultaneously. So, for instance, the person here in the bottom is not very affected by this position, but the person in green its trajectory, it's modified by these future predictions of this person here. So we do it at the same time, simultaneously, all these propagations. And by doing that, we are capturing the interactions between all the all targets in the scene. Here is an example of the experiment that we were doing. This corresponds to a visualization of the environment, but these were recorded in reality, so this is actually real people. And in this case, we were studying the interaction between the volunteer and a person. And then on a second interaction, we were studying this interaction with robot. So we recorded with several volunteers, lots of experiments. And the objective of this experiment was to obtain the set of parameters that were describing the different behaviors. So we ensure that just one interaction was taking place at a time, and each dot of these graphics corresponds to the estimation of just small observations of the draw parameters. So we clustered all these data into three different behaviors. Here in this graphic, there is the model of the exponential interaction force, and here we are projecting just into of its parameters. And we observe three different behaviors. One is we have called the aware behavior, that is the person tried to stay as much as possible away from the robot or from the interacting person, so it was very conscious on its trajectory. On the other hand, there is the unaware behavior, that it's just the opposite. The robot was going through the robot or through other people, and it was not really interacting. It's also important to distinguish these situations because it might be dangerous. So updating this belief that being on our behavior is important. And also the balance behavior, that is between both of them. So with this system, we were able to record some experiments. What we were doing is operating the robot in an environment, and we were just recording the positions of people over time. So they were reacting to the robot because it was in this environment, and also to other people. And we tried to score which was our prediction accuracy. So we are comparing our methods with a shortened prediction that is just a straight propagation of the current velocity. And clearly, after a couple of seconds, this prediction degrades. We are scoring this performance just by comparing if the prediction is actually on the real position after some time. This is a variable amount of time. And after 10 seconds, the shortened prediction is not able to predict at all, while our prediction in green, just using the social force model, and in red, we are using the behavior estimation. After 10 seconds, we are able to hide a good performance. Using the behavior estimation enhances the interaction prediction that we are doing, because now we can get a more precise information between the interactions of the robot and people and the targets that we were studying. So this closes the first part of my presentation, and now I will start talking about the work that we have done in robot navigation. So in this initial approach, we were just considering a little part of we have studied on the prediction, and we proposed a completely reactive approach that was based on the social force model, and we have the following hypotheses. Since the social force model was able to describe human movement, we wanted the robot to move according to that model. And by doing that, we believe that if the robot was moving like a person, then the acceptance will increase by other pedestrians. This hypothesis we proved to be wrong by some reasons that I will explain later, but it was the initial motivation to do this work. So the requirements for this navigation, we have a map. We have also divided this map in a set of destinations. And we are connecting these destinations depending on the visibility between each of these goals. So imagine that the robot is here in this initial position. and we want to get to this goal. So applying a graph search technique, this graph of destinations, we obtain the set of the destinations or the goals in the scene that we want to follow until we get to our final goal. And this is because we must ensure that there is visibility between the current position of the person and the destination that is going to reach, that tries to reach. With this set of destinations, we can calculate directly the steering force. Just recall the social force model that I presented before. So we have this force steering or attracting the robot to the goal that we have calculated. Also, there are other interactions in the scene, like interaction with people, with other obstacles, and so on. So the summation of all these components will be the resultant force that describes the robot trajectory. We have weighted all these components by some parameters, and this set of parameters is the theta variable. So now we need to calculate which are the values for these parameters. So we will calculate this set of parameters according to a cost. We have defined social work. It's inspired on the classical definition of work, so it's of course by the increment of the path done, and it's composed of the robot cost and the people's cost. So here in the people's cost is very important because we are describing the impact that robot is doing on the scene. So if this interaction force is high because the robot is happens to navigate very close to a person, this cost will be high, and we want to minimize this cost. So with these functions, now we can use an optimization technique. We sampled thousands of navigation queries, and we were sampling these theta set of parameters to obtain the best outcome for this navigation. So here is the simulation environment. As I said, it's very important to test this on simulations before going to the real world. And well, we were sampling it's of the components of the robot that was describing this navigation. The robot was doing circular navigations, circular trajectories, and well, it's over thousands of go-to queries. So the parameters that we obtained were these ones. And with these parameters, we were ready to validate our navigation algorithm in a real environment. So we are comparing this reactive approach, the social aware, with a teleoperated approach. In this case, we had an expert controller that was doing the same that robot was doing. It tried to reach to some goal in environment, in the Barcelona robot lab, and we were recording the amount of work for the nervy people and for the robot work that our algorithm and the teleoperated approach were doing. So clearly, the amount of work that the robot is doing using the social aware is better than the one for the teleoperated, and the cost due to nervy people, it's better too. Here, there is a video showing this implementation in a real environment when the robot was commanded to reach some goal, and well, we were just showing its performance. The second section on the robot navigation, we directly implemented the social aware model into a robot car, into a robot task. In this case, this task is the walking side by side. So what is walking side by side? If we want to distinguish between just following, that is getting to the same position that the person that we are accompanying goes to, and do it in a more intelligent way. So that's why we have called it walking side by side. In a more intelligent way implies that we are somehow inferring which is the destination that the person is going to. And here will help us the work developed at the beginning in the intentionality. At the same time, we want that this navigation is reactive to the environment and does not collide or do other things. So as I explained before, we centered that robot, the extended social force model. We know the destination because we can calculate the target's most expectable destination. And we have a second steering force, that is, the robot tries to stay closer, close to the target. There are interaction forces due to obstacles and to other people. And the resultant force is a weighted sum of these components. So again, we will calculate this theta parameter for this case. The difference will be now the cost, the function cost. So we want to accompany and working side by side. It means that we have to find these three regions thanks to the proxemics and the anisotropic factor of the social force model. And our highest score will be when the robot stays in the in this B region. So here is the simulation environment that we have used. There are multiple people, and we try to accompany this orange cylinder. So there were multiple objectives, lots of people, and after thousands of simulations, we could obtain these data parameters, and we also could validate this system in these environments. So we were ready to test it, evaluate it in a real environment. In this case, it's a control environment, PFMA, where it's accompanying a person and it's reacting to the environment. So here the accompany task, as well as the reactive approach that I have just described, have some limitations. The trajectories that this system is describing are fine, but it could be smooth, right? It could be better. So we detected some limitations, and although the task was very well executed, it just makes us think that this system could be improved. So the limitations, and this is obvious, when doing experimentation with people, it's very hard to evaluate and validate. You need to take care of this, how to describe the testing. It was hard part. As I said before, our hypothesis proved to be wrong. It's not because the social force model is not accurate. It's accurate when the situations are simple. But when the complexity of the environment increases, like there are lots of obstacles, lots of people, then this model is not able to capture the real human trajectories. We observed also in these complex environments that were problems such as oscillations and local minima. And these problems are very well known for reactive approaches. And under certain configurations, the system did not behave as we expected. It's not just that the robot was moving good or not. It's the outcome was not really taking into account the impact to the people. So just the system was not well described for a large and varying set of configurations. So there are some advantages. However, it's very fast to calculate a solution. We are directly calculating reactions that the robot has to do. And we have proposed an initial step to measure the social impact. And it's essential because we want to deploy these robots in urban environments. So somehow we need to take into account this impact. And using prediction information has enhanced the accompany task. We believe that using prediction information in our navigation will increase our performance. With these lessons learned, what will be our next iteration? Well, we will deal with this problem applying correctly kinodynamic constraints to the robot. Also, temporal constraints will be important because we are in a highly dynamic environment. We will use more modern planning techniques to avoid these problems that are well known. And we will be more robust to these changing environments by defining better the multi-objective cost that we want to minimize. It's not only a single cost, but multiple. So the last part, the last section that I will present in this final contribution, all the components that I have defined are considered here in the anticipative kinodynamic planning. So we have the same problem. We want to deploy the robot in the presence of people. And here in this picture, there is the visualization of the robot. But now we are not considering two-dimensional on two dimensions, but we have added this set dimension just considering time, because temporal constraints are essential in these dynamic environments. The outline of the algorithm, very just I will present very briefly. It's we need to get information from the scene, which are obstacles and people, and then using a kind of kinodynamic RRT, we generate lots of paths, and then we will choose which will be the best path that we will use to calculate the next action. So this is calculated recursively at 5 hertz, and at the next iteration, again, we will observe the scene, calculate paths, and choose the best one. People state, I have defined it before, is composed of position and velocities, and now we are also considering in the state the time component. These are the differential constraints that update this system. And for the robot state, we will consider a position and its orientation, derivative, and time. Here are its constraints. For the RRT, it's the classical definition of the RRT, but our approach has some peculiarities. So we are not planning until we get to the final goal. We are just planning up to a certain time horizon. To do that, we have a prior requirement. We need a global map to have the information that where will be the final goal and if we will be able to reach it or not. And it is done in an anticipative way. That means that the prediction that we will be using, it's not only calculated once. It will be calculated for each of the actions that the robot will do. So for each path, will be a different prediction depending on the robot position. So these peculiarities are defining these functions on the extent function, cost to O, and the find nearest vertex. And in this video, I will show the components of the elements of this of our planner, the simulation environment. Since we are not planning up to the end, just to a time horizon, the workspace is defined by this circle, so it's like the upper bound that we will never reach beyond it because there is no time. In blue, there are the paths that we are calculating, and here is people in the scene that we are predicting, now projecting its predictions to the two dimensions. But since the collisions need to be checked in three dimensions, we are also propagating its positions, as I explained on the trajectory predictions, over time. So now we will talk about the extent function. This will generate just a single path. We are calculating these paths in depth. So in the previous example, we had two people propagating in an environment. Now we have two people and the robot here that is given this goal to reach this position. So thanks to the social force model, we will propagate the state of the robot trying to get to this goal. And at the same time, it's reactive to the obstacles that are nearby to it. On the next step, we will propagate the people positions, same as before, trying to get to its destination. And we do it iteratively. First, propagate robot, and then the positions. And if you look closer at this figure, the current predictions that we did at the beginning are not exactly the same that the ones that we have calculated just when the robot has propagated. And this is due to the robot impact that robot is, that it's doing to the scene. So just by projecting, by propagating this trajectory in this scenario, the prediction of this target has changed. So we want to minimize this impact because it's what we have called we have called at the beginning. We wanted to reduce this impact that robot is doing. So it will be a very important part of the cost that I will define. This was just for a single path. How can we generate multiple paths? Well, at the beginning, I presented this circle. that depends on the time horizon and the velocity of the robot. And we will sample over the edge of this circle these random goals. The sigma parameter of the sampling depends on the amount of people inside the circle. And for each of these red dots, we will generate a path. We are also introducing randomness into the generation of these paths with these beta parameters that are weighting the summation of forces that will describe the trajectory. Which are the multiple objective goals that we want to consider? So we want to get to the goal with a given orientation, but it's also very important, robot cost, and especially this cost, the nervy people cost due to the robot path. So we have defined here these five different costs, and we need to project this cost into a single function. Well, this was our initial approach, but it proved to it shows some problems doing that because the conditions were not exactly the same. It's not the same just considering a single person, that multiple. And these costs need to be normalized before we can project it and do the linear combination of these costs. So we have used an error function. And now with this normalized cost, the cost function is better defined. And we observe that we are able to describe more different scenarios. It's also a function of the RRT, which is the nearest vertex where we will start propagating our branch. Our initial thought was to use a Euclidean distance, comparing the position and velocity. This was not really very significant of the amount of distance that we're connecting the new configuration, all the vertices in the tree that we have built so far. That's why we have proposed to use the cost-to-goal function. Starting from each of the vertices, we are propagating the robot until we get to this new configuration, new goal. And we will choose as the best, as the nearest vertex, which one has the lowest cost, the lowest cost. I will show later the difference between using just an Euclidean function and this cost-to-goal function. It's very important in these environments, dynamic environments. So here are the simulations that we provided. As similar before, there are multiple scenarios. In this case, we have two obstacles. There will be also people and the combination of and obstacles and people. And we were commanding the robot thousands of times to reach a goal in this environment. So we were recording the cost that we're generating after sampling the weighting parameters of the cost function. We did lots of simulations, and we tried that these environments are very different from each other to have a more representative sample of what will be reality. The second part of the experiments, we were interested in the solution coverage. It's very related to the use of a cost-to-goal distance function or an Euclidean distance, since we are connecting states that consist of position and velocity, and we need to provide this distance function. So for the free space, there is no problem. This is the all the trajectories that we are calculating on a single iteration of the planning. And in red are the paths that are visiting this area. So when there are no obstacles, both approaches more or less visit the same area. But the problem comes when there are multiple obstacles. So clearly, using an Euclidean function is not able to cover as much as possible with all its trajectories, the space solution that we want to sample. So if we want a better solution, we need to sample these all our paths we want to visit the maximum possible region. Here are the results for this idea. And we were increasing the number of vertices on a single iteration of the RRT. and we were averaging these results. So for the Euclidean distance, we performed better at each as we were increasing the number of vertices, but not so well as we were to, using cost to row function. So we will choose to use always the cost to row. Here in simulations too, we were comparing the performance of our both PKPs with the reactive approach that I defined before. Clearly, the reactive approach was not able to perform so well. And these simulations were done on these multiple scenarios with obstacles, people, and we were providing different scenarios to have a more complete results. And the difference comes for the IKPs here in the amount of execution time is similar. Here the difference is bigger when we are comparing the people cost. And we believe since we were providing multiple number of people, in the complex scenarios, the cost to was able to find a better solution, while the AKP using the Euclidean function was not able to provide a so good solution. So at the end, it will probably get some solution that is, in this case, impacting highly the nearby pedestrians. The fourth part of the experiments, we implemented all these methods, and we will compare it to the some state-of-the-art methods. In this case, this is the dynamic window approach. It's not able to replan on time because it's not considering predictions. The reactive approach that I talked at the beginning of the robot navigation. This is a clear example of local minima. It was the worst situation for this kind of navigation where we were frontally colliding the robot, and it was not able to solve this interaction. And here are the testing that we were doing with the IKP that was able to foresee future trajectories, and it reacted to these interactions in time. The results for this comparison in a real environment are as follows. We were measuring three different scenarios. A rear side interaction. The robot was behind person and it tried to reach a destination. For this, our method scores better, but not so well, while the interaction with people is lower, while the average time is more or less similar. Here for the front side, the dynamic window approach is able to score very well, because it's able to foresee its obstacles. They are treated as static obstacles, but anyway, it's able to replan on time. And the average time is better for our algorithm, but more or less the same. And the reactive approach is not able at all to deal with this problem. And the interesting case comes here with the frontal interaction. This is a more complex interaction because you need to advance the prediction of people. And here, clearly, our algorithms outperforms the other two, both in time and the impact that it's doing to nearby people, because in these cases, it's much higher. Here we show some experiments on real environments where we were performing the IKP, as I have explained. And we were in the control environment because we wanted to isolate these interactions, just a few interactions, and we wanted to ensure that there were actual interactions. In real, now the control environments, what we found is that recording interactions was very difficult because no one was interacting. The students on the personal robot lab were just sitting. And here we have some examples that people were told to walk to wherever they wanted, and the robot had to reach this final goal. Here there's last example where we were crossing its trajectory, coming from the rear, frontal interaction, everything at the same time. And the robot could successfully solve this navigation. Well, now the conclusion. So here are the summary of contributions that I have presented in this presentation. At the beginning, I presented the intentionality prediction. And this component appeared on the following sections and proved to be very important. We also divided the map on a set of destinations. that was a key component for our navigation approaches. We have used the social force model and extended to treat the robot and people interactions. And we provided human trajectories, and we have enhanced these interactions by calculating the behavior estimation to get a more precise trajectory prediction. On the social aware, we proposed our initial drone navigation that was reactive. It was our first, our initial step, and we learned lots of things. Then we provided multiple objectives to evaluate, because if we want to deploy these robots, it's not only important getting to a place, but also it's important to reduce the impact that robot is doing. And we were combining prediction with interaction, which was not easy. But at the end, and this had its advantages, so we could do it in an anticipative way, that it was not only using prediction as a constant and not moving set of trajectories, but we were changing these trajectories depending on the paths that that we were calculating with robot. Here is the publication that I have done while I was studying all these things. On green, there are two works that have not been published yet, but I hope that it will be done soon. And, well, other conferences, journals. And that was all. Thank you very much for the attention and for coming here.
Okay, thank you very much for the presentation. Now we go to the second part, which is the debate with the candidate and the comments and questions from the members of the committee. So the first is the secretary, is Professor Alquizar, that may have some questions and comments.
Well, first I want to congratulate you and your supervisor for your excellent research work. You've made some very nice contributions to the fields of human motion prediction and social mobile robot navigation in urban settings. Okay. Also, you have some very nice publications, high quality publications. And for me, it's especially amazing the huge amount of experimental work you've made, especially in the real life experiments, which I know are very hard to do. A lot of problems, effort. This must be assessed very positively. Okay. Then I have some small number of doubts or questions. For instance, about chapter 3, when the proposed prediction indicator, you say it's you classify this in prediction indicators between geometric base and place dependent. Mm-hmm. But as I have understood, all of them require the coordinates of the possible destinations.
No.
You need, well, in the case of your indicator, you need the coordinates of destination candidates. Okay. So then, what additional information that depends on the place are used in the place-dependent methods? The particular trajectories. So what's the real difference between what you mean by geometric base and place dependent?
Yeah.
Because I'm not quite sure about this.
Okay, I will
put this
slide. There's a big difference. For the place dependent, it's not important to have defined a destination. It was just for comparing. So we choose that the place dependent, the ending of this trajectory corresponded to the final destination. So that's how we were able to compare it. We were scoring right or not. The main difference is that you have to learn for each of the environments which are these primitive trajectories that the persons are doing. And it's very, very hard to learn because you are not able to translate it to new environments. So for the place dependent, you will need to learn, for example, in this environment, which are the typical trajectories.
Okay.
And the number of primitives, the problem is that it increases exponentially with the number of of destinations because you need to do the combinations and get all these. And we believe that this approach is good if you have a very simple environment with few destinations like a corridor or indoors. And then you are directly depending on the positions that you are observing. So in this case, yes, you need it. For the geometric approaches, well, we have called it adapted because it was not really using destinations. It was using a grid, this other approach, and each of the cells on the grid could be the goal that they were reaching. But once you have this set of destinations, you can define it manually or using any other technique, then your algorithm is ready to be used. There is no additional learning depending on the trajectories that you have observed. They don't depend on the positions once you have defined these goals.
Okay, that's good. One thing, do you have the document here? Well, in page 31, it's a figure that you have also shown in the slide. The performance results, yes, you have also, I think, a slide. Okay. When you finally reach the destination, performance is less than perfect. What's the interpretation of this? That the method is predicting a different destination. So that it's like predicting, I have reached one of the destinations, but there's some probability that actually I will go on my trajectory and go to another different destination.
In which line?
It's page 31.
Well, I think it was
referring. It's the previous.
Previous.
I have page 31. If I describe it, previous to that. Mm-hmm. The figure 3.7. Okay, this one. So, when you end the trajectory.
Yeah.
The performance is not 1, I think it's 0.8 or something. So, what's the interpretation of this? See, when you reach the destination, there is some chance to go to another one, no? Or...
No.
What's the interpretation?
Yeah. Well, the reason is how automated this process. Mm-hmm. So, at the end, my final goal was just a region in the scene. And sometimes these final destinations were ending on a point that was not any of the goals in the scene. So this will mostly correspond to incomplete or very, very abnormal, which means that they will not reach any of the goals in the scene. So I didn't reject these trajectories. I wanted to score all of them. So I put all of them in there. It's strange not to score a 1, but it is because these set of destinations are sometimes not describing the whole reality.
Okay.
So if I have defined a complete set of destinations, and well, then yes, but you need to maintain a low number of these destinations.
Okay, so some of these trajectories did not end in the goal destination.
Exactly.
Then it's wrong.
So it was not possible to classify it according to how I was validating this data.
Okay.
Jumping to chapter 4. I have not understood quite well all the process of behavior estimation, in particular the clustering, and why, for example, you use only or you determine in some way 3 clusters.
Well, that's the problem of the EM algorithm. You need to know the number of clusters that you will choose before running the algorithm. So if we're just trying 3, there is no explanation why I'm using 3. There is no automation on this.
Uh-huh.
It simply explains world reality. Because okay. At the end, and you see here that there is a height variance in this balanced behavior. I mean, everything could be included here. But the problem is you could not, with this model, it's not possible to obtain a so precise description of reality. I mean, this social force model provides an idea of what will happen in the future. So just selecting these three different behaviors, by doing this, we were able to enhance a little the social force model. But it's almost impossible to describe reality because people is very, very different. If we can do it continuously and try to obtain update these parameters in a continuous way, but the problem is not that. This model, its only purpose is to describe more or less reality, because people predictions are very hard to be completely determined by just a single model.
And yeah, I've also understood that these behaviors are adaptive over time. I mean, you may, for the same person, you may change the behavior during the experiment.
Yeah. This, so. In this video, I was plotting the on this cylinder the behavior that I was estimating at that time.
Uh-huh.
Right? Okay. So it now changes, and at each iteration, since I have this observation, I can be updating this information. So you can see that the interaction with the robot here was in red. It was because this volunteer was just walking through it. Mm-hmm. And according to our model, it was not reacting. So that's why we were classifying this as red cylinder.
Okay. There are some technical questions that I think it's not necessary to. Then jumping to chapter 6, the companion robot walking side by side.
Mm-hmm.
I have a question, because I think for people that take the people detection, you are using the front and back lasers of the robot, okay?
Yes.
But in this task, usually, no, the objective is that the robot is in a lateral position of the person and going in parallel, no, with the same orientation, more or less. So how you detect that the target
person? We had this problem, that's right, because we have two lasers that have 180 degrees, but they are separated by 40 centimeters, right? Okay. So there's a blind angle just at the side of the robot. So what we said at the beginning is that we are walking side by side, but it does not mean that you have to be at the same. So the robot was slightly preceding the accompanying target. So here in this example, you can see that it's a little advanced with respect to the people. And it is because if you came closer to the robot, then the detection was failing. You were not detecting anyone. And we solved that here. You see here is the position that robot is trying to maintain.
So you always need to be a little bit more advanced.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, because if not, we have a lot of problems.
It's not exactly side by side.
It's not side by side, not in the sense that it's 90 degrees, but it's better that just being on the rear of the person and being following it. The feedback that we obtain is that this behavior is more intelligent than just following a person. And even though we had a lot of trouble when detecting and tracking these.
Yes, because due to reactive behavior, I think sometimes you actually got to the lateral position.
Yes. Well, thanks to that, we have a tracker that tries to maintain the detections, but sometimes it can fail. Yeah, it's real one.
Also, in this task, does the target person exerts an attractive force in the model? That's clear.
Mm-hmm.
But does it also exert a repulsive interacting force?
Yes.
You need two of them.
Yes.
The corresponding.
Yes.
I assume that, but I didn't see it clearly in the.
So it happens a lot with these kind of models. Mm-hmm. you find this equilibrium point. So even okay. though you have this attractive force to the target, uh-huh. gets repulsed by the interaction force. So there's it's because it's not so does not behave so well when there are multiple obstacles, because this equilibrium might change a little. But this problem was well known a long time ago. Okay. We were just showing the company task and well, how can we be implemented.
Okay, and when you evaluate this method, you compare with the same method without prediction.
Yes.
Okay. In the case without prediction, which destination goal is set for the robot?
There is no...
No destination goal?
No. It's just following.
Okay. Okay.
It's... Yeah.
So the
because using this prediction information really make the system perform better, a lot better. So we could have named it just following, but we said no prediction.
Okay. Okay. And finally, for chapter 7, which is very sophisticated approach, and that you integrate all the elements of your thesis. You said that, contrary to what one may expect, it's not very computationally costly. Well, you say you computed in runtime.
Yes, yes.
No? So then, and you say that this you can be able, you can make this fast computation because of a steering method. Could you explain a little bit more about this, because yes. I have not understood.
Yes.
Well.
The answer is here. Typically, what you do in dynamic planning is just sample some states and you try to connect these new. So it's very costly because you need to solve the inverse connection of two random. Sometimes it's not even feasible. Mm-hmm. So we are speeding up this connection because we are planning on depth, right? Mm-hmm. So with this, knowing that we have a goal and applying directly the social force model uh-huh. with some modifications, because here the update, the system state has orientation and other constraints, we are able to propagate it very, very quickly. So the sampling is just done here in the for these goals, and it's very fast to calculate a path because we are just propagating, okay. right? So it will be a lot. At least you will need, I don't know, 20 seconds or 1 minute to calculate the whole path if we were sampling and trying to connect it. Try to solve the inverse trajectories to connect these states.
So you use the social force model to propagate?
Yes.
Instead of
instead of trying to connect states, we yeah. propagate.
Okay.
At the end, the reason to add this randomness is because you wanted different solutions. Uh-huh. If you do that, you may be biasing your solution yeah. space. And we avoided it just sampling with different goals. And also this part was important because it generated different trajectories, even for the same final goal.
Okay, so
it's a price to pay sometimes to be able to do it on real time. Because if not,
yeah,
I don't know if it would work.
Okay,
probably not.
No, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you for the questions and comments. Now let's go to the second member of the jury, which is Research Professor Rashid Alami, so you have done your turn.
Okay, thank you. So I have first to say that I'm very happy to be here, and particularly for my vision, but also because for the subject that you are dealing with, that I like very much, I'm very interested by the subject. So really, I'm happy to be here. I was here also for the beginning story of TB and Dabo, even when they interacted together.
Yes, yes, yes.
a famous night, okay? And if I was here too, we had the first real interaction with both of the four.
Yeah, I was here.
you were here very young at the time, I think, yeah. Yeah, so you, yes, so you started from the beginning, and you know everything. So because of this, it's more and more interesting what you are doing here. Also, I already mentioned, so let's say it again here, that I liked very much in my report your document. That was very good. I mean, the work is very good, and the document is very good. Also, you have done very interesting, state of the art. That I think the successors should read and use. It's very interesting and very well done. And there is another issue that I would like to raise. And I think that's why this kind of work is interesting, that also you raise a number of questions. Of course, you do not solve all, raise a number of them. And this is what we are interesting. We are really doing a research activity, looking at the problem. I mean, honestly, and because it's a very difficult problem, it seems very simple, navigation between people. So stupid problem, I would say. People do it anytime. And you are showing to us how much this is difficult, how difficult it is to build a model, how difficult it is to design a model. We'll come to this, so the discussion, etc. And then to build behavior based on this model and to validate it, etc. So this as an introduction. Another thing that I think you have insisted, you have essentially worked on it, and I like it very much, is that you have looked essentially on the dynamic part of it. Robot in dynamic realm. There were also some work on robot moving between static people, okay? Rather that we are not mentioning that much, etc. So we are looking at this aspect, which I think is indeed very interesting. It's a problem I'm looking at also right now,
yeah.
That I think it raises a number of very interesting problems, etc. To the point that if you are not going to the US, I would say I have proposed to you to hire you. But well, I'm going elsewhere, because I have a project to continue this work. Now we'll go to the questions. I have a number of them. I'll ask only part of them because it's not here at the time. So the first one concerns what you said, which I think is important, is this issue of the methodology working, because it is important, particularly in this environment. You mentioned this, it's completely true, I agree with it. Methodology where you have a simulated environment, a controlled environment, and then an open or non-controlled environment to run the tests. But however, perhaps it was too fast, or it was not sufficiently clear. In your simulated environment, do the simulated agents that are moving there, do they respect the social rules, etc., that you are implementing, or not? I mean, the you know, these green cylinders that are moving there.
You mean if they can collide?
No, not only collide, but they do the same as humans do, respect social rules. Avoid another in a social way, react to your robot, which will disturb them. Okay, do you, because you are using this environment also for doing some kind of learning. So for me, it was not that clear. I know a number of folks that were not doing this. They are using, they are a number of pedestrian system, pet
sim. You are asking if I was using an external system that was modeling that there are lots of...
Here, for example, the green, are they doing any social behavior?
I found a big problem by implementing other methods that were doing this prediction. There are plenty and they are very good. But my problem was, I want this system, this simulation, to be... aware of the robot, right? So it was my essential concern.
So,
and it was not for me so easy to model these other methods that were just studying the human trajectories and human interactions, and it was not easy for me to adapt it to my method, just to consider the robot and do the simulation. So what I did is just applying the social force model that I have calculated. The interactions between the cylinders were just the calculated directly using the social force model, and the interaction between the robot and all the people was calculated as I explained before. So this is I built this simulation because I was not sure that other methods could handle the presence of the robot as I wanted to do. So maybe they are describing better some kind of behaviors between trajectories, but it was implemented mainly because that in this environment it's not so important to consider the interactions here in outside or far from the robot, but it's very important to consider interactions here in the robot, and that's why on the last simulation that I show on the last chapter, I'm not plotting so much people because it's not. It does not help my system just to simulate people that are very far away. So I was at the end. For me, it was very important to concentrate on the nerve of people and model it more or less according to reality, and using another simulating environment of pedestrians. Maybe it would be not so good.
Right. Okay. Just understand. Okay. Now, I have another question. Yeah. And I like also very much your first part, which is the human prediction part. So the first part is in estimating the destination. Yeah. How much is it important to estimate the destination? Because I think for it depends. If there is a goal, is going to the door or going to take an object, etc. But for navigation, how much is it important to have a good estimate of the destination? And because as far as I see, you are not exploiting it completely at the end.
Well, you mean on my robot navigation approach?
Even though I think it is very important to estimate destination for other issue. I mean, not for navigation.
I think I'm exploiting it quite well. Maybe it could be done better, and I will be interested in hearing your thoughts. But the difference, I think it's you will see here in this figure. The difference is huge. You need to know it is better to define the set of destinations on the map than just describing the interactions in a short area. So here you can see, I think the difference between enhancing the interaction in red and not enhancing the interaction. Here you have a worse interaction prediction, but at the end, what is really important is knowing which is the final destination. So for me, it is essential. And I think I have used these destinations as good as
I. So what you call behavioral estimation is integrates goal.
No, both of these integrate goals. Okay. And the difference is huge when you compare to short distance. That here, you are not considering goals at all. So here, the difference is, I don't know,
it is better for whom? For the robot? For the human? For example, will the robot allow the human to reach his destination? Will not disturb him?
Yes. Because
do you take this into account in your evaluation?
When you consider the whole cost of the person propagating, it's important if you are. Here in this graphic, it's important because if you have an accurate information what the propagation will be, it can be used then to estimate which is the impact of the robot that is doing on this scene. So for me, it was essential. There is a problem that you may estimate it wrong. On the document, I talked about the multi-hypothesis, trying to describe multiple paths, but then the combinations exploited.
So would be the goal somehow? Three goals. Me, the robot, I reach my goal. All the humans have reached their goal.
So and, you go to the same place then?
Yeah. No, they go to their place. Okay. Mm-hmm. And it was done in a social.
It would be socially acceptable, the outcome of my algorithm, considering there are some situations where this problem, what this may be a problem. Just imagine that some person is going to this destination, the same that the robot is going.
Yeah.
So here you have a problem, because you try to get there, but there is also somewhere in that space. And yes, but it's obviously happens to us humans, happens the same. You want to go there, is someone is.
Yeah, but however, it will be okay if you reach the goal, then I reach after you, for example.
Yes, yes. I think the outcome for the robot will be always to stay, not try to get to the goal, but since there is someone here, it will stay close to its goal, but it will have not reached its goal, so it will be in a trap, in a just waiting to get out. But yeah.
Okay. I have another question, because we'll come to the social force model. Okay. But before coming to this, in the prediction that you have done of humans, and this is something that we are looking at now a little, how much is it important, I would say afterwards, to take into account the orientation of the head of the humans, where they are moving?
There are some studies that try to track the pose of the head or the AI's gaze. And they say that, yes, they are increasing its performance. I heard another work that was presented at IROS 2013 that said it was not important, because they were recording it, and it was from Japan. I will look at it. But yeah, it seems like there is information. Our initial thought was to track these heads of people.
Yeah.
The problem that we thought is that we are in outdoors. So the system to track that will be very difficult. But at the beginning, I was considering just to build a system that was able to not just to provide positions of people, but also tracking heads.
Yeah.
But on outdoors,
I know it's difficult, but I'm asking a question in an abstract way. Okay, how much do you think, in your opinion, independently of the experimental difficulty that you had?
Yeah.
I know how it's difficult to run it.
I think
outdoors.
It seems important, but it's not so important. When you are moving, the most important thing is the trajectory that you are doing. When you are on a static position, I mean, working on a planning, doing things, then your head pose is very, very important. So I will distinguish between these scenarios where people are actually very dynamic and they are moving on the scene. In that case, I think it will be not so important, just where you are looking at.
Mm-hmm.
Because most of the time, we are looking, where we are trying to get, not to collide. But when you are doing other things like manipulating or, I don't know, but you are aesthetic, then the head pose, I think, has more information. I don't know if you were considering this case of static prediction, but
I'm not sure. I would say, because there are a number of folks also saying that the human, they have their head which anticipate a little where they are going.
It seems like that, but after considering the problem, I don't believe that information may be may increase so much your prediction system as comparing to observing past trajectories, because there is a lot of information in the past that you have done.
Okay. Now I will go to the other question, number of them. One concern this social force model. Okay. So you base a lot of things around it.
Everything.
So I like it, I would say, even though it doesn't seem to me enough. Okay. No, it doesn't seem to me enough, and that's why I'm asking you again the question, because also what you are doing shows that works. It doesn't work that well. Okay. So have you any remarks? For example, you know, there are other models, for example, taking into account proxemics, for example. You have the L shape and the activity area where people, you know, like the reserve area of interaction, which make you can use kind of social norms to avoid this area, etc. So there are other models that can play a role, and I think they play a role globally in interaction. And so that's why I'm asking you the question, because also, for example, I know also some studies where, for example, people sometimes only adapt their speed and not their trajectories to avoid each other. Okay, there were some new studies have this by Stefan Glasauer in Munich, etc., which doesn't seem to follow completely. I mean, in a simple step, okay, the social force.
Yes.
So again, I'm asking you globally the question: what do you think about it? And should we invest more on this, or should we mix with other models?
Okay, so I agree with you. The social force model has limitations. Mm-hmm. It's very clear, and I showed on the first and second chapters of the robot navigation. You take a look, what I've been doing is just extending these limitations by applying other things.
Yeah.
So I think other models may be interested. In this thesis, I thought the following. We were studying social force model, and we will do it till the end. So it's a study in depth of these methods. They have limitations. I'm every day more convinced of that.
Yeah.
Other models may be working better. The proxemics, I think, for the dynamics environments is not good, but even Helbing has proposed new models. And at the end, this social force model is just a potential field. And there are lots of trouble with these kind of approaches. Yeah. The last chapter that I have presented is somehow how to overcome the limitations of potential fields using other techniques, but at the same time using this like old-fashioned technique. That's right. But my idea and my thought is that any of these interaction methods is complete by itself. So you need to build all the things that consider the problem more globally. If you want the definite model that will describe perfectly your predictions, does not exist.
I agree.
It's very difficult. So what you have to do is evaluate. And the social force model, its main advantage, and I think it's very good on that, it's just not to predict and base everything on that. It's very good to evaluate future.
I will come to this.
So for me, I will discuss that any of these methods that are not describing paths, but it can very well describe the quality of the path, because you are evaluating easily, and you don't have the other problems that are related to this reactive.
Okay, thank you. So let's continue a little of this, because in the social force model. In fact, we will come to this just after that. So I will ask the question and come back. You distinguished between aware and balanced.
Yeah.
So can you re-explain a little? You mean people who are aware of me, the robot, aware of the others? People who are not aware of the others? What does it mean exactly?
Yeah, it just means that, it's just an interaction between a couple of targets.
Yes. They mean one is not aware of the other.
Exactly. Because in our example, we were testing this. And this person was just wandering here. And the interaction was estimating the behavior that this person was doing with respect to this one. But we were calculating also the opposite. In this case, we were not interested because it was not a volunteer. It was someone that was there. And for this case, is the same problem. We could be estimating the behavior of the robot, but we are modeling it, so it's not necessary to estimate. So in this case, we are only estimating this person with respect to the volunteer,
So this person is not aware of the volunteer, or what?
When it was in green, it was the balanced behavior. It was not aware, but not unaware.
But why?
Because
it was not seeing it, or it was ignoring it. What?
It was reacting as we were expecting. So if you notice here, it stays not very close to the interacting person, but stays a little far, but not so far. So it's this non-defined behavior that we are simply saying, okay, it's not aware, it's not unaware, it's in the middle. Here is more or less satisfies these conditions, but
so as you can see, it is based on satisfying the conditions.
Yes, you're updating at each instant of time. If, for instance, at this point, this person would do an avoiding maneuver, then we will classify it as being aware, because it will try to stay away from it. But it's
But for example, if a guy was not seeing another, and you see, I'm coming back to the head orientation.
Then you are unaware, because you are clearly not interacting with that.
Yeah, but
that
target. You can measure this?
Yes, yes, you are measuring it at each instant of time, and you are able to react and adapt in time. So even though here the interaction was supposed to be balanced, when the target clearly comes very close to the robot, it says, no,
he's not aware.
Because it is unaware. You see here, it's unaware, and it will happen that...
Which means he does not respect the social force.
Yeah.
Yes?
Yes, but...
Because he is not aware.
Yeah,
doesn't measure.
But if you see the color scheme is different, because on the videos it was green. But if you see here, yes, the unaware is completely not interacting. But you are modeling it as having zero parameters. It's
But some people could be non aware of some people and aware of others.
Yes, exactly. Yeah? So you have to calculate for each pair of interactions, which is the state of this.
Yeah. And do you take into account the environment? For example, they are hidden, or it's normal that they are not aware because there is a wall between them, you know?
No.
You see, or there is, for reason or another, he doesn't see them. Okay.
No, it's not so intelligent. Right now, we are just basing our estimation on trajectories. So, if there was a wall
because here you have upper view
here, and we see that this person is more or less propagating, being aware of this.
For example, it's normal that the guy who is coming from the corridor is not aware of the people in the middle. Yeah,
but that's why we were testing this on this controlled environment, because we wanted to ensure that the interactions were taking place. So it will be the next step, just to consider our structures and how to combine it.
So if we come back to this social force, was it possible, ask you, because you have looked at this very well, and I would push my students to read your thesis in detail to understand this very well. Because you have done a lot of very interesting human prediction. Did you test if you effectively, I would say, identify the social forces between humans and able to predict and play them again, between humans only? You have a scene.
Yes.
You measure, you analyze it, and from this, you take one of the people and verify that what your model is predicting
is actually correct or not.
Yeah.
Well,
again, based on social force.
Yeah. We were interested in just in the robot and person interaction.
Yeah.
I know other works that have done this, and I think they were somehow conditioned, because on their study they were simulating trajectories with the social force model, and they ask people, say, do you think this is what actually a person would be doing? And they obtain that no, that the trajectory generation using only the social force model did not very well describe the human trajectory. So it depends on the study. I believe that this social force model has not to be taken, and I think it's written on the document, has not to be precisely. I mean, it's not the definite prediction of trajectory. It's a useful information that you have in the near future.
Okay.
But it's, I think...
So you should not push it until generating acceleration from the forces.
Yes, it's at the end, I think it's more important to define the set of goals in this scene, even that the interaction forces may be described by the social force model, but sometimes the model is not so precise. It's very useful, I insist. I have done all these things with the social force model, but it's not reality. I mean, you cannot see. You need to change your mind, and you will never get a model that describes perfectly reality when there is people. So if you just consider it, and I did, this model is useful. If you expect to have a reality prediction.
Because then you use it, and there's another question which I would like to see how you use it essentially to compare with the social work. You call it social work? The work of the social force?
Well, it's the initial definition that we use to. Let me see if I have it. The social work considers the force that each of the targets is doing at the difference in the with respect to the path that he has. The difference. So somehow it's measuring these for the interactions. It's measuring the amount of force that robot is doing to all the people. Mm-hmm. And if as a result of this high interaction, the people move, then this cost will be higher. It was our initial function, and we wanted to consider this impact. But at the end, I did not consider this as the best cost to describe the environment. I used simply the summation over time of these interaction forces.
Okay.
Because it was describing better the reality, the impact that it was doing.
Yeah.
Again, it was very important to start thinking on these issues, but it's not the definite.
And do you think you can, at this level, even, my question is, how much is it important to integrate the dynamics of the motion?
It's essential. If you can see in this video, here we are not considering dynamics, right? So on simulations, nothing happens, but in reality, the robot is not able to do that. So even you can calculate a good path. If this path was calculated using these jumps, it will be you cannot do it in reality. So considering dynamics. Very important. Considering these constraints, it's also very important.
There are two issues of dynamics. It's this one, which is changing very quickly direction, okay? Which we have published some paper about this, which creates confusion also. Even if your robot is able to react very fast.
No, but we solved this problem.
Yeah. Okay. But my question is linked to the fact: is it going very fast or accelerating very fast? Okay. How does it influence the other, in terms of social, you know, because if you are going fast, you push the other far more than if you are walking slowly.
Yeah.
If you are hesitating,
again, if you try to measure the impact of the velocity just in a single model, the social force model provided a new version just considering these velocities. But I think it's like trying to compress everything into a single model, and it is not correct. In our case, for the reactive case, this question cannot be answered. So mm-hmm. I will not consider velocities, but on the prediction of on the anticipating approach, I'm considering velocity because it's not just a devaluation of the position on the current configuration. You are propagating it over time.
Yeah.
And this propagation entails some velocity of the robot. So it's important you are. You are just doing it on a very different way. Not solved directly by a model, but you are considering it by just this time horizon that mm-hmm. Evaluates a whole trajectory.
Okay. So I have another question. So for me, it's linked partially. Now, when we place ourselves from the point of view of the robot. Partially, there is another criteria that I like in what we call social human aware or social aware, is the fact that the robot is, I would say, predictable or legible. Okay.
Yeah.
So giving information of what it will do next.
Yes.
Okay. And so perhaps in the speed already, if it decelerates suddenly, yeah, it will give some kind of information, you know?
Yes, well,
if you see, I see you, I decelerate. Okay, so I inform you. It's not only I avoid collision,
yeah,
it's also I inform you.
Yes, yes.
Social signal, you know, exchange between the robot and the human. And so is, can you this, can you take this into account in your framework?
Yes. If you are navigating and there is no one in the workspace of the robot, mm-hmm, that is considering, then the robot goes to maximum velocity. If there is someone, then the velocity decreases. It naturally decreases just by considering the forces. So the best path that you will choose, let me see. The best path that you will choose will depend on the, also you will choose a path that has less velocity, because by doing that you will reduce the impact that you are doing on the scene. Directly, you also want, not directly, but you want to also consider that the robot is not changing so much your intention, because then there is no way that humans can infer what the robot wants, yeah, to do. And I think that's on this cost, on the robot cost. So we want the robot to stay as constant as possible. So if there is no input, it stays on the same state. That is, if it's propagating at constant velocity, it does, yeah, till the end. If this cost is high, it means that it's maneuvering a lot and doing a lot of things. So you also need to take care of this cost. But I think that the main cost that will take into account this will be this, the cost due to a robot being on doing to other people. So it's not directly studied. It, mm-hmm, might be. I haven't done, but my intuition is that in these two costs is inside this these two costs, yeah, that do the robot be,
and
more.
You try to play between the different.
Yeah, costs, a lot. But I have a lot of problems. This, yeah, you can get, yeah, crazy if you have more than two costs. It's so
nightmare.
That's why I start reading to multi-objective optimization. And one technique that they were using is this normalization, not using an error, but they were dividing by the maximum number. Well, there are several techniques, but, mm, it's by doing that you get a well-defined problem.
Yeah.
If not, it was very, very difficult to combine these costs, but because, no, it's impossible. I would say no, never.
Okay, guys, too long. Okay, I'll ask two.
You have 20
two,
more?
No, two of them. The accompanying task. What is this robot is doing? It is accompanying or guiding?
Yeah.
Or what?
It's confusing. Maybe it may be a little confusing, but we said that the following task was very simple. It was just staying. For instance, if it's accompanying these people, it's following this person, it will just get to that position. We wanted to express that it has to be a little more intelligent. So it's not guiding, because if it's the guiding task, then it will be even easier. You have this set of goals that you want to reach. What we are doing here is we try to use prediction information. In this case, we'll be working side by side to this person. And we will use this prediction information in the sense that we know where this, we can calculate where we think that this person is going to.
So it is adapting to the.
Exactly. So the
but in the video that you are choosing, it happens very often. Clearly, the girl,
yeah,
seems to follow the robot and not to have its own will.
Yeah.
You see.
It
happened to us too.
Yeah,
I know this kind of experiments with you with humans.
It's what I said. It's one of the limitations. It's very difficult to do testings with humans, because how can you say that, okay, be more natural? It's very difficult when you are next to a robot. So designing the experiment.
But why haven't you put the because you could have, you can localize the person behind or little ahead.
Yeah, that's
because I know you have a part,
yeah,
blind part,
blind spot,
but still a little ahead. So if the robot was a little behind,
it's a little ahead. Here, there is the
this target, target
person,
yeah.
And you can see here it's this white cylinder.
Yeah.
This is the ideal position that we want robot to reach, because then on the cost function we will score higher, because we were not interested in following. That will be being staying behind the person. Yeah. We wanted to stay not side by side, because we found technical problems, but just a little ahead.
Yeah.
So it was like here. I think it's 1.5 meters and 60 degrees from the orientation.
Okay, but still you are adapting to the this person.
Yes.
You are predicting where they are should go. So, and is your scheme working even in crowded environment? I mean, the robot will momentarily go behind to because it's narrow passage, then come back, or
what or usually happened when there was a lot of people is that the robot simply chose to stay behind the person. And it was, yes, we are predicting its position, but at the end it was like following. So these examples were not nice to see on a video.
Yeah. Now, if it reach out, catch up, it's only provisional, stays behind, then again there is room so the robot catch up.
Yes.
If then it will show that it's really a company, which we do, we are company. Sometimes we are behind.
Yes.
Then when there is room, we catch up.
Yeah, but it's difficult. This maneuvering was difficult for us. So once the robot was behind, it was difficult to recover and being again, because there is no enough space, at least on the uncontrolled environment. So the experiment was finished. The robot was trying to reach, but it never reached.
Okay. And is there or do you think you need speed adaptation?
Yes. Yes, there is. There is. I haven't presented here, but we have some rules. Limiting the maximum velocity that robot is doing, depending on the people that is inside its nervous region. So we have three different regions.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. So I'll come to the last question. I will stop here. So again, I like very much the work, and also I find it very interesting for this last part when you do, and I fully agree that anticipation is the key aspect. For planning, and here clearly then you have the model, I think, that may include the social force model and others. So I like very much, and I think this is there, that there is a lot to gain there.
Yeah.
I'm sure it's very interesting. So I'll push you a little more to this. It's also, for example, it should be interesting to anticipate people you don't see. Okay. Not only people who are there.
Yeah, I understand. Like in a crossing,
it's possible that somebody will get out from this door. Okay.
Yes. It's something I have thought, but at the end we never implemented it because this was not challenging. But yes, you're right.
Yeah.
And maybe it's.
And the last thing I will ask you is that you have used the social force and work partially to evaluate. And you mentioned also, I fully agree, that it is very difficult to evaluate.
Yes.
This also be very difficult to measure. But and there is a discussion, you know, in the community about this, so how to evaluate, not easy, it's still the question is open, etc. But still, have you done a little of user study, or did you plan to do some kind of user study and ask people if they are happy with the robot?
You mean like some polls? Well,
you can do different ways. You can do it by questionnaire.
Yeah, we did a questionnaire.
Or also by measuring physiological sensor data, you know, on humans, for example.
On the first part, on what you said, I think it's a difficult problem to evaluate systems with people, but at the same time, it's very interesting being there, because right now we don't know what to do.
Yeah.
So I think it's very important, because next systems that will be developed, we need to define these evaluating conditions. We used some questionnaires on the companion. The results were in the document, but I haven't shown here. And I don't like this method to evaluate because at the end, volunteers are very conditioned by the environment, by the robot. So yes, you have results. Some authors say that they are basing completely their results and their evaluation on these methods, but I don't like it. It seems like they are not clearly showing reality, to me at least, because,
well, yeah, I can show the results that.
So here are the results for our questionnaires. We were asking if they thought that the robot was intelligent and if it was their level of confidence. It gives information, but on the last section, I have not considered to use anything and was just about waiting.
That's why if you want to go to HLI, you have to do it.
Yeah, but it's the same problem again. You need to define better ways to validate these systems. Maybe it's not the best thing to do a questionnaire, because the HackRI community do these things a lot. But I think if there were other means to obtain because it's just a reflection of reality, if this system is working or not. If you could get that, maybe you will do a very interesting thing. I've been thinking, but I haven't think anything good enough to.
I think it's open and difficult.
Yeah.
So thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. I also like the thesis, so congratulations for the thesis, and also the document. I agree is good, and also my congratulations to the supervisor for the work. After so many questions, I have the intersection of my question is low. I cannot real time invent some of them. But anyway, when I read the title of the thesis, social interaction. Social interaction in urban environment. This is very rich, right? Social need. But in practice, you are very concerned by obstacle detection and avoidance, right?
Yes.
Which is the main issue, right? Because social the problem is obviously, okay, when you ask, for example, about what is the robot doing? So the kind of missions and the kind of environment and context. Of course, we have to accept that this is a very complex problem. And then we have simplification to deal with this problem, even with the numbers. So you see at the beginning a very impressive number of people moving around the street. Okay, I'm not going to ask about the numbers because, okay, there are not so many practical experiments, but about the kind of interaction. So you define aware, unaware, and the third was some kind of mix, right? But aware in practice means some kind of far away. That means aware, not other kind of awareness. It's far away, right?
Yes.
So my question is, do you think that in practical problems is the only behavior? Or aware could mean another kind of awareness. For example, consider a mission of the robot to provide information to the people or to give something to the people. Then in that case, aware is to go closer, not far away.
Right? Maybe it was not the best word to define this situation, but the aware in this context meant that we were trying to, that this we want that the target stay away, that's right. But since the aware word appears again and again, it may be confusing, that's right. But it's very important to define these interactions very correctly. So all the interactions that are taking place are not the same. It's important if they stay far from this interacting target or stay very close. Maybe I can change the name to be more clear. But you need to distinguish between these situations, because if not, you can have some problems.
No, I think that the main thing is because the motivation of this definition is collision detection and avoidance. If you want to do something additionally, you have to define possibly, okay, you have to change the name or to put another behavior, to be close to somebody, to offer something, to, I mean, other kind of behavior. You know what I mean?
Not really.
To define? The social interactions means something more that what we are analyzing. In that way, we should be able to be stopped, grow somebody, yeah, to give something, to associate with somebody. Okay, you put the work together, but this is a very particular case.
Yeah? Just a task. Yeah, yeah. At the end, what we want is to deploy these robots in a urban environment. And the task is, what is if the environment is very complex? So the initial idea was to understand these environments. To do that, I defined the unaware, the aware behavior, that it would be, well, its name can be changed. But the task is very simple. If you want to deploy a robot, you need to take care of these things. You need to understand these things. So yes, there are a lot of concepts, but at the end, although the task is very simple, you just want to navigate. I think you need to understand all these things that are happening. Sometimes we don't realize, but for me, it was essential to define these different things, and then you understand better what.
Yes, a comment to what new behaviors to consider this more richness environment, more rich in interaction, because the environment is different. For example, the environment. I think it could be good also to consider a little bit more complex model of the environment to predict emotion. For example, the mall that you consider. Yeah. Assume a mall. Then in a mall, you have a number of exhibitors, information, and so on. So yeah, this information affects the kind of motion,
yes,
and the behavior of the people. Because people used to stop in that place. And then this is very useful to predict that they will possibly, yes, stop.
Yes, you're right, completely right. In that case, I think that the definition of the destinations that I have in the scene would change a little, considering these shops or other interesting things. And just by defining this new set of destinations, you have the same problem again that I have just defined. It's not that the environment is different. No, no, the environment, it can be defined like I have said. You can also do a place-dependent classification of the shopping mall. I think it was on Japan. But I think that with the information I have explained here, you can easily define it, because you will add then a destination, I don't know, in the entrance of a shop or a cinema or a bar, I don't know. And you have this information because you will be observing at each instant of time, and you will be understanding what's happening. Maybe it's not so rich as it would be if you are considering more things, but the general definitions, I think, can be applied to any.
Yeah, you can always define adaptive or dynamic destinations, but you still want to go to the end of the street. Yes. But I mean, for a while you stop just to see a little bit or to interact a little bit. So
yes,
it is not change the destination, but yes, some kind of to have a why, to look,
yes,
a why.
In that case, I implemented an heuristic that if the detector is just seeing that someone is stopping, there's this hidden destination that is okay, you will stay where you are, you are stuck. I haven't talked about it, but it can happen. So in that case, it's defined, it will be defined by my model. So it will say that you will try to stop, you will try to maintain that position. I don't know if you are watching something in the street or you are talking to someone, I don't know. But under this description, it can be, the model can be very, very complex, but I try to explain it in this just by using this set of destinations. And I think that very complex models can be explained just using these destinations. It's not perfect, but I think it can handle lots of configuration, okay, situations and rare examples like this one.
No, I just wanted to say that having some kind of model of the environment and the task will help to,
yes,
better predict and,
yes,
finally.
Definitely, but then you have a problem that you're depending on knowing this information or not.
Of course.
So it will be better because you will get better performance, but you need to know where you are. And maybe it's an additional problem that is not.
Okay.
The trade-off, maybe it's not so good, but I think it's better to have a generalizable model, and I think it can be applied to many situations.
Okay. Just at the lower level of the forces. Sometimes I think that I was thinking, if I was wondering, if you want to model people, if forces usually we have some kind of threshold, right?
Yes.
I don't know if you need to put a threshold in the forces. I mean, if the force is lower than something, just ignore it.
Because like
people
an
use like this. I mean, people used to behave like this.
Yes.
Just ignore completely something. So, okay, you can eventually modify the velocity and stop a little bit, but in practice, people ignore some kind of forces, right?
That's completely right. It's just like an hysteresis process where some forces are not taking place if they are very small, but that's the key point that I was discussing with Professor Rashid. The problem is that the model is not completely describing reality. So yes, you have these uncertainties and you have to deal with that. And I think this model deals with these problems, just considering the different behaviors and all these things, and maybe it can be considered here. But if you start just providing these new things to the model just to be more accurate to reality, at the end you will get monster of rules that are not practical to be used. So yes, it happens, but it's just model as uncertainty. So some things maybe are not considered, but our model sets, okay, you may be propagating, but it's part of the limitations of this approach.
Okay, now in the last part of the thesis, I wanted to see a little bit more about the multi-objective approach. You just mentioned some kind of scales and the weight,
yes,
and so on. Okay, scale and weight exist. And the problem, obviously, is that the weight changes dynamically. So that means that depending on how are the level of satisfaction of every objective, the weight changes. So, okay, I understand you, but starting by your comments in the conclusions of the thesis, you mentioned that, there is two kind of approaches. One is imitate humans, and the other is centering the robot. You mentioned that in the conclusion. And this last one was centering in the robot.
Yes.
Okay. However, in my opinion, there are two levels here. One is to generate this non-dominated solution of the Pareto optimal solution, which is something which is optimization problem and so on. But later on, when you have defined this, you have to choose the preferred solution.
Exactly.
And this is a matter of preference of humans.
Exactly. Yes.
And this feeling of preference of human, how far you are to achieve your objectives in general, or the level of objective that you want, is in some way more dependent of the humans, right?
Yes, yes, yes. So the robot, for instance, may have its own parameters. I haven't showed this slide, but
yeah,
this is the problem. So by itself, no combination of these parameters is right. It will just depend on the election that we were using. So I sampled a lot of navigation queries, and then I obtained the parameters. The problem is that in this case, we have this same parameter. We have the obstacle parameter, this one, weighting is the linear combination of the cost. And for this case, it's a decreasing function of the cost that we are obtaining. And for this different case, we have an increasing cost with respect to the same parameter. So what can we do now? We need to choose some. It's maybe a weak part, but it's typically done. So on the multi-objective optimization, it's typically done putting some humans, some preferences, someone that can decide which will be the best set of
models. Modeling the preference in a second.
Exactly, exactly. So what we did is simply trying to find a solution that was performing well according to our objectives, that were not only getting to a destination. In this case, we see that just reducing the subject, the parameter of the weight of the obstacles, you will have a very high cost on the obstacles. That it's like the robot will stay very close to the obstacles, and that's not very desirable. And the other hand, yes, you have very low cost on this, but you need to choose a weight on the middle. So by try and error, we found these parameters.
I have some expertise on this. So do you have any kind of graphic in which you compare, for example, these two objectives, obstacles and distance, in the same graphic, in the way that you can observe the Pareto optimal or non-dominated solution? Do you have any kind of graphic?
It's a four-dimensional curve. So it was very difficult to plot. I did it for two dimensions.
Yes,
just selecting two. Yes, but
Let me see.
Just with two objectives.
Yes. I think it's this one.
Yes.
Okay.
This was taken from just considering two objectives. And here I'm selecting the Pareto front that gives this non-dominated set.
You know the problem with this? That you can assure the convergence to a solution if it's convex.
Yes. But
however, this is not convex. In many cases like this, the non-dominated solution surface is not convex. And then if you iterate in this surface, it's hard to assure that you converge in one particular direction.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yes. However, we are not looking for the Pareto optimal. So these methods, what they do is iterate, and at the end they get this curve to be richer. We are just getting these sets of trajectories. In this case, it's one corresponds to a trajectory, just sampling the results that we have obtained on the RRT, right? So we are not iterating to get the best. We are simply ignoring the ones that are dominated. And this is just because to avoid the non-convex problems that may be happening if there were these convex areas in this. Most of the times, this is convex. But yes, it can happen that there is a non-convex, especially if we are sampling this front. And that's why we were just considering the non-dominated set. But yes, it's a very complex problem. And if we were just providing, I don't know, thousands, millions of vertices and lots of paths, maybe we will get a more dense estimation of this curve. This is just a two-dimension. What happens in four dimensions is that it's very easy to be non-dominated. So most of the solutions appear to be on this Pareto front.
But okay, no, I understand. Again, I think that you have a bottom-up approach in which you start from the beginning and the real physical problems, and then you try to solve to give some solutions, even if, of course, you have to simplify the problem. But I think that is perfectly acceptable or even very good. So, again, congratulations. And if you do not have more questions, I have to ask also to the audience if you have any, to the doctor, I have to say, to the doctor, if any of the doctor have any additional question? No? So, if not, thank you very much again for the presentation, and we will meet for the next one. Okay? So, Mr. Ferrer, it's our pleasure to communicate you as president of the jury of the committee that the qualification of the thesis is excellent. So congratulations on behalf of the members of the committee. Congratulations. Okay.
So we can celebrate it here in the room. We have something to bring into it. So please.